This is the Umidigi A7 Pro. Now, most of you have probably never heard of this brand, and as you can tell, I probably am not even pronouncing it correctly. Several years ago, I acquired my first Chinese phone. It was a Xiaomi Note 4. Took me a while to figure out how to pronounce that one as well. It was a fantastic piece of kit. It was really well built. It had a lot of good features, and it was very affordable. As time has progressed, other Chinese manufacturers have joined the club in order to try and unseat Xiaomi. They haven't been doing that great a job in unseating Xiaomi, but they have been doing a great job in creating good quality hardware. As with most of these brands, you have to be careful when they're new. Quality control isn't the greatest on these brands at the beginning, most certainly. It gets better as time progresses, but usually I would give it a few years before I give a brand a try. Now, Umidigi, I don't know. I'm going to stop trying to figure that out, has had quality control issues on their phones. There is no denying that. And even this phone does have a minor problem on it, which I've come to accept. It's fine. But just to be clear, you have to be careful. If you get one of these phones, make sure you test everything before you accept delivery, basically. So when you order from one from AliExpress or DX or Gearbest or Geekbuying, whatever the site may be, they have pretty good customer protection for lemons. So if you get a phone through one of those sources and then you wait the month or two or three to get the phone, make sure you test everything. Okay, and I mean everything. Make sure GPS works. Make sure all the cameras work. Make sure focusing works. If it has an FM radio, make sure that works. You know, everything you can think of, make sure it works. The problem with this phone specifically is the headphone jack, the balance isn't correct. The right side is slightly louder than the left side. It's very apparent to anybody's ears. I'll play a short sample if I still have it.
For the largest selection of Hunter Douglas window coverings, smart home automation, blinds and shades, and transform your home.
Fortunately, there is a way to fix that with this phone in that you can go into the accessibility settings and adjust the balance manually. It's not a big deal. I could have requested a partial refund maybe, but you know what? It's okay. The biggest reason for these phones is they are cheap. This phone was $100. And for that price, it is a great value. Okay, so I mentioned Xiaomi. What's the problem with Xiaomi? Their prices are still pretty good, but the biggest problem with Xiaomi phones, for those of us in North America, is they do not offer full band support. What I mean by that is, for North America is a little unusual in that providers in both the United States and Canada use a lot of different bands, but several of those bands are not used anywhere else in the world. As a result, most Chinese phones, which tend to target the Chinese and Indian markets, simply don't have the bands that we need here. And that is the problem with Xiaomi. They make great phones, but the majority of their phones, especially on the more affordable side, support for band 4 and band 7. They often have support for band 2 and band 5, which are necessary in North America with most providers. But they have zero support for band 66, which is used by T-Mobile and by Freedom Mobile. But most critically, they do not have support for any of the 700 megahertz bands. Why should you care? Because the 700 megahertz bands have the best penetration and the best propagation distance-wise. So if you are even if you're in an urban area, but you are inside a building or a shopping center, it's important to have 700 megahertz band coverage. If you're in a more rural area or you're traveling, it is crucial to have 700 megahertz coverage. If you do not, your phone will drop to band 5, which is 850 megahertz, which is extremely congested, and even drop off LTE and go UMTS, in which case you won't have any useful data. So, Umidigi, this phone especially, but many of their phones, has fantastic LTE band support. This phone supports band 12, band 13, band 17, all the major dual direction bands in the 700 megahertz band used in North America. It does not have band 29, which is okay. That is a downstream only band used for carrier aggregation to get more performance. I can give that a pass. But it has band 66, it has band 2, 5, 4, 7, almost every band you could want in North America, as long as your provider isn't really unusual, like Sprint. They have some really odd bands that are used very infrequently. This phone's great. So that's why you get a Humidigi phone. So let's get into the phone. Build quality, oh, there's always dirt. Build quality is stellar. This thing feels great. It's solid. It's a brick. I will say it's heavy. This phone is 212 grams. Okay. That doesn't sound like that much, but my primary phone is a V35, an LG V35, and it is 158 grams. Doesn't sound like much, but 50 grams is a lot. Now, it's also thicker. Do I mind? Absolutely not. You know why? Because this phone has a bigger battery. I've said for many years, I just wish providers would give us phones with bigger batteries. It would be so nice if they did. I don't mind a phone that's slightly thicker and slightly heavier. Just give me more battery life. A phone that barely lasts a day. How is that still a thing? So this phone has great battery life. So we're going to get to the screen here. I have to admit, this is a $100 phone. You can't expect too much. But frankly, this phone's LCD is one of the best LCDs I have ever seen on a phone. I was blown away. It really, really is bright. It's well-defined. The colors are pretty good. I won't say perfect, but they're pretty good. Viewing angles are okay. They're not the greatest. But that's okay. Saturation is very good. This phone, you can tell they're really trying to make it compete with like an AMOLED screen, which they can't, but it's a $100 phone, okay? Its resolution, screen resolution is a funny thing. For the longest time, having a screen resolution above 1080p was the flagship, right? Every flagship had a screen above 1080p. But times, they are a bit changing. If you look at Google's latest Pixels, they're actually 1080p phones. If you even look at Samsung, they have gorgeous AMOLED screens, and their screens are 1440p. However, if you enable the higher refresh rate, I think it's 90 hertz, it actually only presents a 1080p screen. So this phone, it's only 60 hertz. It's not 120 or 90 hertz, but it's beautiful. Its resolution is 2340 by 1080. So it's not a 16:9. It's what's more typical these days. No jelly. When you scroll on this thing, it looks great. One complaint is its auto brightness feature is not the greatest. I actually have it turned off because it was starting to annoy me. That said, I've been annoyed by most auto brightness features. They're just frustrating on how bad they are. Now, cameras. This thing is loaded for cameras. Unfortunately, as is common in everything but the most flagship of phone, it has four cameras, but really two of them are useful. Okay, so what do I mean? Well, the primary shooter on this thing is what you typically expect. It's a rather good camera. It does quite well. The pictures are good in good lighting. They're up there with, you know, upper-end phones. White balance is not the greatest. That's one area. It doesn't always get white balance right, but okay, that's not that uncommon. Very little distortion. The lens seems to be pretty good. Good detail. When light goes down, it suffers. It doesn't do as well as the more modern flagships, but it's very usable. It's a very good phone for pictures if you're not too picky. Anyways, the second lens on here is an ultra wide. I personally cannot have a phone without an ultra wide lens. The pictures you get from an ultra-wide lens are just not anything you can get any other way. This camera, the ultra-wide, is good. I won't classify it as anything near perfect. It has a bit of distortion. There's a good amount of noise, especially as light levels get lower. And the problem that exists with the primary shooter exists with the wide angle, and the ultra-wide angle, and that is white balance. It really misses white balance, especially as light levels go down. But you know what? It's still great. I really like the fact that it has an ultra wide angle that isn't hampered by, like, you know, 5 megapixels that you sometimes see. Now, the third lens, in no particular order, it is a macro lens, 5 megapixel, I believe. It's bordering on useless. Now, if you've ever done macro photography, you know the challenges. Lighting is a major challenge in macro photography, as is depth of field. In this form factor, with not a great lens and not the best sensor, it really suffers in trying to do macro photography. I've taken a few shots here. I've struggled to get anything beyond useless. It's okay. It's a feature. I wouldn't buy this phone for its macro lens at all. I would consider that, you know, an extra. The fourth lens is the most common extra lens on many phones these days, which I find particularly absolutely useless, and that is a time of flight lens. I think it's rated, the camera is rated 2 megapixel. It doesn't matter. You can't access the pictures it produces anyways, because it is used to produce the bokeh effect. It does a decent job of portrait photography with using that lens. I personally, I'm not a fan of that. And my problem with this camera having a time of flight lens is, one, it can use the ultra wide to do that. So why do you need another lens to do that? And second, even without that, Google has been doing relatively good portrait fake bokeh with just one lens, one camera. Right? They do it through computational photography. They take multiple shots in the background, they use that to determine a 3D map, and they can use that to create the fake bokeh. There is no reason to have a hardware time-of-flight sensor. Phone manufacturers are putting this lens here simply to boost the specs. It's a waste of money, it's a waste of time. I can't wait till they give up on it. It's ridiculous. On a phone with an ultra-wide lens already, it's even more stupid. Something that a lot of people forget about with modern phones is, what is the cellular radio like? People have really forgotten about that. Coverage is pretty good. I rarely see any comparisons anymore about, you know, this phone has better coverage, better reception than that phone. It's an area I would have left out in this review, were it not exceptional. This phone is exceptional. Yeah, that's the problem with a glass back, which is gorgeous, I admit. Oh my god, is it slippery. Anyways, the radio on this phone is exceptional. Whether it's the antenna design or whatever, you know, they're using for radio reception. Is it just moving by itself? Honestly, every time it is. Look, sliding by itself. I swear, I'm not touching it. Wow. On the 700 megahertz band, which I spoke of at length at the beginning, this phone is exceptional. On average, I see it having a signal reception, received strength, between 5 and 10 dBm better than my LG V35, which is very good. I've never had any complaints about its coverage. It compares very well to other phones I've used. It holds on to LTE sites very well in the lower bands. I've seen it hold on to a 700 megahertz signal well, while my other phone on the same network has already dropped to UMTS, which is incredible. That's really, really fantastic. And it's not just the lower bands. So the way cellular providers design things is that the lower bands are used for reach and the upper bands are used for bandwidth. So if you want a lot of data bandwidth and you're stuck on a lower band, you're not going to get it, especially in more rural areas. This phone will jump on to band 2, so 1900, band 4, 17-2100, or band 66, AWS-3, very, very frequently, when the other phone won't. Now, I don't know if that's just the designers of the radio firmware have made this a little more aggressive in switching to upper-level bands. I'm not sure, but when it switches to those bands, it has better signal than my other phones. Which, again, the radio reception on this thing is, you know, the cellular radio is just fantastic on every band I've been able to test, which is great. If you want a phone that can reach pretty well, get this phone. It's great. Finally, the one area where it's a $100 phone, performance. This uses a MediaTek processor. For those who are not aware, the phone in your pocket most likely well, if it's an Apple phone, it's an Apple processor. But if it's not an Apple phone, it's most likely a Qualcomm processor. Unless you use Samsung, in which case it might be their Exynos, I don't know how to pronounce that word, but Samsung makes their own processor. The problem with Qualcomm is they're expensive. You want to know why Samsung phones have gotten so expensive? It's because the flagship, there's multiple reasons, but one reason, most certainly, the flagship processors from Qualcomm are just prohibitively expensive these days, especially if you're going 5G. MediaTek, people have certain opinions about them. They are, I believe, a Chinese company. They make their own processors, obviously ARM-based as well. And they're known for being lower performance, but they're cheap, really cheap. This phone has a MediaTek. The One Air, this phone, it's $100. In many ways, it doesn't feel like a $100 phone. Oh yeah, fingerprint reader on the back. I love that. The only thing I don't like is the power button is here, and I hit that all the time. Drives me crazy. Performance, not stellar. Okay, it's usable. You will have lagginess when you're scrolling things. There's no denying that. So, for example, if you do this, you probably can't see, but it's lagging a bit. It's not horrible. It's not great. Okay, when you start apps, it takes a while to start the app, a little longer than a more flagship phone. Using apps is pretty well. Scrolling, again, is not perfect. Using Chrome or, say, the Reddit app, you see jerkiness sometimes when scrolling. You can't expect flagship out of this, okay? But it's darn near close in many areas. What comes in the box? So first off, here's the phone. As you can see, the back is just, I love that. It looks beautiful. Unfortunately, I never see it because one thing that comes in the box, which I really appreciate, is a bumper case. I always have my phones in bumper cases. It does mean you have a pretty phone, you can't see it, but oh well. What else do you have in the box? The box is really nice. It's really nice. Good presentation. I give Apple credit. Because of Apple, good presentation is now everywhere. So, typical stuff. A little packet here with stuff I've never even looked at, honestly. It comes with a little SIM card tray pin thingy. It did come with the screen protected. Oh, I should mention, it has an installed screen protector, a plastic one. It's not a glass one. I didn't take it off. I see no reason to. That's a nice addition. So yeah, the screen protector and the bumper is included in the case, which is really nice. Comes with a little message. Thanks for, you know, very sweet. Building a great phone is hard enough. So, yeah. Oh, there it is. Okay. Anyways, comes with a charger. I usually throw these out. What's this one rated at? Okay, it's a 5 volt 2 amp charger. Not anything special. And it comes with a USB cable. I guess I should mention certain things. If you don't, it didn't already know. It is USB-C. It has a headphone jack. Yay! I don't know, people might laugh. I need this. I use it all the time. I don't like the wireless. Too many problems. It does not have any form of fast charge. So as a warning, even though this has a USB-C port on it, I don't believe it is PD compliant, power delivery, USB-C power delivery compliant. The reason I say that is if this phone is powered off and I plug it in to a USB-C Pixel charger, so PD, I believe it's PD2 compliant, I'm not sure, this thing won't charge. It won't do anything. If you turn it on, then it will charge sometimes, I think, with that charger. If I plug this phone into the USB-C port on my computer, it doesn't charge, which is weird. I don't think this is a fault of the... I don't think it's a bug. What I think is they simply put a USB-C port on this thing. But fundamentally, it's just a basic USB-C, a basic USB 2 device. So for charging, the most this thing can do is 5 volts, 2 amps. So you're getting 10 watt charging no matter what. There's no NFC, there's no wireless charging in this thing. So it's not the fastest charger, but here's a chart of it actually charging. And that's not too bad. I was pretty happy with that. Very steady. It was an odd charge curve, actually. I didn't expect it to be so linear, but it was. Has an FM radio. I hate where the power button is. Like, why? I hate it. It's what really frustrates me about it is the spacing. The volume controls are spaced further apart than the bottom volume control to the power button. So when you're like feeling in the dark, you're like, oh, that must be volume. And no, it's not. It's power. So then it turns on in your pocket. I don't understand why LG is pretty much the only one that integrates a power button into the fingerprint reader. I don't get that. I've had other phones that have the fingerprint reader on the back, which is my preferred location, for the record. But there's no... I don't know. Why don't they integrate the power thing? Does LG have like a patent on that and nobody else can do it? I don't know. Fingerprint is very fast, but you press it and bang, it's there. And it's very reliable. If I put the wrong finger on, it doesn't turn it. So it's not fake, okay? The phone is quite bezel-less, if you see. It goes up to the top. It has a teardrop thing for the selfie camera. Oh, selfie camera, decent, but who cares? I don't care about selfie cameras. If that's important to you, then it's a $100 camera. What do you want? It does have a chin at the bottom. Who cares? I don't know why people obsess so much about that. I actually prefer having a little bit of a space on the side because I get false touches all the time on like the Samsungs that have the wraparound garbage, and that's just me. Highly recommend it. I love this phone. I think it's a great value for... I bought it for 100 US. It often goes on sale for something like that, but even if you're paying 120 or 130, go for it. This is a great phone. Oh, dual SIM. With a SIM tray with three spots. So you have micro SD, SIM 1, and SIM 2. So you can have all three at the same time. Not very common in many dual SIM phones out there. To those who don't know what a dual SIM phone is, don't worry about it too much. The way North American phone plans work, it doesn't have as much benefit. Fundamentally, you can have two different phone numbers on the same phone. Or you can do what I do on this phone, where I have a very cheap calling plan on one SIM and a tablet, $10 a month, 4 gig or whatever it is, tablet plan. So I have data and calling, and I end up paying, I don't even know how much, like 20 bucks a month or something like that for a relatively good setup. You can only do that on a dual SIM phone. If you have a single SIM, then you gotta pay the tax of a little more to get that. All right, I think I've gone on long enough. Any questions, please let me know. Have a great day. Everybody stay safe. Until next time. Thanks.